Parents strongly caution the following programs are intended for mature audiences over the age of 18. These programs may contain some material that many parents would not find suitable for children and may include intense violence, sexual situations, coarse language, and suggestive dialogue.
Why do you play songs that portray yourself as a... What doesn't make any sense? That portray... Why do you play songs that portray yourself as a liar? It's going to be amazing, I think, the day that I actually learn how to utilize the English language correctly. As a matter of fact, I don't even know if that day will come. I would be like the phoenix arising from the ashes the day I could adequately use and utilize the English language as a tool here as a radio personality, as an expert host.
Well, it's not your fault.
Hold on, let me turn you up.
It's not your fault because you, is my mic working?
I don't know. Are you working?
I don't hear myself.
Talk into it.
Talk into it.
Hold on. Talk right now. Ready?
Hello, hello, hello. I'm working.
Yeah, I'm hearing you.
Yeah,
you're good.
It's not your fault. You had a tough ride getting here.
I'm going to tell you what, Mark.
Troubles.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to No Positive Radio, by the way. My name, as always, is Paul Hullabaloo, and sitting actually directly in front of me is not Dirty John Winterbottom, who took the night off. He had a long night out rock and rolling in, Troy, New York?
Yep.
He was out to all hours playing some music. So Mark has come in today for a number of reasons. One, out of cooperative necessity, I think. You came in to share the airwaves with me so I don't have to babble to myself incessantly. Not that I mind doing that because, we all have our gifts. Talking to myself happens to be mine. But he also came because tonight I'm going to actually donate half of my show to... playing to sending out over the airwaves into the ether a album that Mark and I, or I should say Mark and sort of somebody else, put together about a year ago. And the album is a conceptual piece, more of a meditation, this album. And it's a work, it's called The Minx. And at about 8:30, I'm going to play it for the other half hour. And I think it's important for the people out there who listen to this show regularly and who are interested in the... current of this show, the psychological current of this show, I think that it's informative. I think it is kind of a roadmap of memory, of my memory. But I will get to that. Mark, of course, so excellently produced and created all these soundscapes that are on it, and I did the writing and the vocalizations. on it.
I'm in shock right now.
I know, you're nervous. But before we do that, I want to tell you a quick...
You're bearing your soul.
I want to tell you a quick story. Here's the greatest thing that's happened in the last hour. This was an update. No. The last hour was crazy. By the way, I've decided just now, in my mind, I just had the weirdest idea. I think I want to make a movie. I think I want to make Lent the movie. Lent, the motion picture, featuring Sean Connery as Candy and Haley Joel Osment as the kid who gave it up. Sorry. I don't know where that just came from. Lent, the motion picture. I don't know. Maybe there's somebody out there that would actually go and see Lent, the motion picture.
Tell your story.
All right. So anyway, that's a random thought. I don't know. I popped in my head. I couldn't filter it. I apologize. I'm sorry. First off, I want to send a shout out to some dude who's a runner, and his name is Mark. Now I'm going to get to...
He's a rower.
I thought he was like in a running race. Okay, I'm going to tell you about Mark here. This is not Mark, the miracle Mark Wilcox in front of me, but this other Mark. Mark, okay, here's what happened. Mark, this Mark in front of me, the miracle, and I, Paul Hullabaloo, we're on our way here at about 6:30. We turned onto the road that takes us to here to the campus of URI.
We're having a deep conversation.
A deep conversation pertaining to this album, The Minx, and future projects we're going to be working on together, both for the radio show and just for all other avenues of creative thought. So we are driving here. You're right. We're having an excellent discussion. Now, my gas gauge on my truck has been broken for a while. My gas gauge is rendered, you know, it doesn't work, is basically what I'm trying to say. So basically what I do is I get gas and I just keep track in my mind of when I got gas and how much I put in, kind of keep track of when I need to get gas again. However, I am the most inconsistent, irresponsible human being on Earth, so of course that was it. That's just not going to work. I can't trust myself to keep ideas in my head for any more than 30 seconds, so that was a fallacy of judgment. But let me just tell you right here now, we got about halfway down the street, or so we thought, which is a long-ass, like, six-mile-long road from the kind of the highway, Route 4 or Route 1, wherever the hell it is, in the school. Got what we thought was halfway down, and my car is breaking down. So anyway, I'm running. We're out of gas. Out of gas. Mark's like, well, I think actually maybe I don't. I hope this can't be started up. Let's keep going.
Is that the Mark Dirty John
yeah,
voice?
That's my voice.
Well,
that for everybody.
I thought you were joking. You know, you're normally joking.
Oh, you felt the car. I mean, it was ambling off of the road. Go ahead. What?
Who knows with you? I thought you were jerking the gas pedal or something.
No, we were out of gas.
We were out of gas.
So. We ran out of gas, so Mark and I have to realize, we have to make a decision. How far are we down the road, we're trying to decide. We were so, you know, engulfed in conversation that we weren't really paying attention to the road. I mean, what the hell? I mean, you know. Mark trusted my judgment. Mistake number two. Mistake number one was trusting my judgment as to how much gas was in the car in the first place. Mistake number two inevitably ends up trusting my judgment as to which way we should walk. Are we closer to the gas station or the campus? I said, Mark, obviously, we're closer to the gas station.
It's right up the road, right around the corner.
We just turned. I swear, we just turned. Mark's like, all right, I mean... I have to go to the bathroom, and I had too much coffee, but if we have to do it...
I said my big mistake is trusting you.
Yep, and we did. And sure enough, we are like literally 3.5 miles away from that gas station. But we made it in, what, 35 minutes?
We were running, practically.
We get to the gas station. They can't sell us a goddamn gas tank. We have to borrow some girl's gas tank who works at the gas station. She wouldn't even... She was so busy eating a hot dog, she wouldn't even go out to her car and hand me the gas tank. She said, just go in my Jeep. Here, crazy vagrant stranger who stinks of gasoline. Oh yeah, I didn't stink yet. That's right. Oh no, I'm preempting my own tail. Go in my Jeep and go ahead, root around in it. I have to shove a chili dog down my throat. I'm way too busy. The worst thing is we have to bring this tech back. God forbid she's listening to this. We did say we had a radio show to do.
We'll forget,
I'm gonna hang myself. So anyway, I rooted around her Jeep Wagoneer a little bit, and I pulled it out, and we said, we're going to have to walk all the way back! Christ! Now, the whole time, Mark is saying to me, and not insinuating, just flat out saying to me, Why don't we just go to that bar right there? I'm talking French fries. I'm talking a couple of draft beers. And maybe we just call this one in. I mean, is that so bad? We just ask the barkeep if we can use his phone, man. El telefono.
You haven't described the walk down that terrifying road.
It was a brutal walk. Cars were literally aiming at us. I mean, it was horrifying. It was our, you know, distressing sense of logic that dictated that let's walk in the line of traffic so at least if we're going to be killed by an oncoming car, we'll see it coming. I could kill myself at this point. So we walked 3 miles. Ladies and gentlemen, in basement and garage dwellers everywhere, I have to let you know, the last time I don't walk. I don't go anywhere. I don't do anything. That's the problem here. So a 3 mile walk was an ominous and destructive thought. Mark, your thought at this point.
I was tired.
Tired.
I took a piss 3 times on the road.
Yeah, he kept having me stop. And then we get to the gas station, we're in a rush, and he's like, maybe I'll get a Snickers bar. I don't know. You want to have a little snack? What do you think? Should we have a snack?
It was my idea to ask somebody.
And I'm like, Mark, I could kill you! We can't have a snack! There's no time for snackages! So anyway, we started walking again. Go ahead, you have a thought.
Don't forget to tell everybody how you pumped the gas into a little gas.
So I try to pump the gas in this little 1 gallon gas tank. Son of a bitch, is that difficult. That gas is rocketing out of the gas nozzle. What is that? What is that all about?
Well, they're not used to you filling up a gallon little container. It's got to fill.
Holy Christ! Mark's like, you better go very slow because I'm going to tell you now, this could be a disaster. So I'm squirting the gas in, and I'm trying to measure by lifting the nozzle out. Is it gas coming out? Is it filling it up? I can't see where the gas is, and all of a sudden, gas is just spraying recklessly all over the parking lot. My new goddamn shoes, my jeans, my hands. I am. No exaggeration. I'm covered in gasoline at this point.
Definitely.
Long story short, because I got other things to talk about here. You know, we finally asked some random kid. There was a carload of girls, and Mark's like, well, maybe we should ask them. I'm like, I would rather drink the gasoline. I would rather commit World War II Harry Carey right now,
cut my intestines out,
than have to... I look like two dirty rapists on the side of a road. Hey, you guys go to you guys college girls? Yeah, you want to have something to eat? You guys want to take a nap and give us a ride? So, of course, we asked this burly rower from URI named Mark. He's like, yeah, I'll give you a ride. Here's the best thing. And he literally said this. As long as I don't get stabbed. Oh, well. And we're like, well, we're not going to stab you. And he's like, oh, okay. So I guess it is easy to be a serial killer nowadays. I guess it's that easy. You just have to tell him, no, well, I'm not going to stab and murder. I'm not going to slit your throat, let the car go flying off the side of the road in a bizarre suicide pact. No, I'm not going to. Look at me. I'm so handsome. Why would you make you think that? So anyway, long story short, I wanted to thank Mark and the gas station girls shoving chili dogs down her throat.
And the nice lady waiting.
There's some weird lady waiting at our car, broken out of the side of the road. She's just waiting for somebody to show up. So we show up, and she's like this little nebbish, strange woman. She's just babbling incessantly about how her dad taught her how to be a good sport or something. I don't know, and a good Samaritan. So, I kept thanking her, and Mark, thank you. And I'm like, thank you. And she's like, it's fine. You want me to follow you? You want me to move in with you? I want to have dirty sex in the back of my Ford Aerostar? I don't know. But
I think she was concerned when she saw you. You couldn't even put the gas in your car.
Yeah, I go to pour the nozzle, the 1 gallon gas tank in my car, and I hadn't attached the nozzle or whatever it is tight enough, and the gas poured out in the grass. Bizarre. I'm like T.S. Eliot. Did you hear me? And then the gas poured out onto the grass. Sorry.
So we made it here.
So anyway, and then I'm like, I appreciate it, lady. Thank you. You're a good Samaritan. She's like, no, I'm a nut job. That's not just not a joke. She really is like, no, I'm a nut job. I'm like, okay, go back and find the bridge you crawled up out of. So.
And we did have the guys with the cell phone within 5 seconds.
Yeah, we broke down, and there's a carload of hip-hop kids with dangling a cell phone out the window. I'm waiting if there's like a suburban drive-by or something. He's like, yo, dog, need to use my phone? Need to use my 7-4? Want to get in my 5-0? And me and Mark are like, whoa, I don't know. It's like so leery of talking to other human beings that we don't know personally and haven't seen each other's, penises. We don't even know how to talk. If I haven't seen your penis in a public restroom, I'm not going to talk to you. That's how I categorize my friends in life. So anyway, that's that. So let's move on. What is that called? A segue. Let's create a segue. Let's create some connective tissue here. How do we go into this right now? How do we talk about this album, The Minx, that we're going to be playing for the listeners? By the way, I'll take a couple calls now while I'm talking here. If you want to call in and say hello to us, 792-9030. It's the number, 792-9030. Can you go around there and get the little phone clicker? I think it should be dangling. It's like a little white thing. I want to talk about this album, The Minx. You know, we finished it about a year ago, except... Oh, we'll take a call. I'm trying to think of how to bring this up, how to give you a preface for playing this album. Let me take this call. Hello.
Hello, is this there, John?
Oh, man, not that son of a bitch!
I can't believe that.
No, I'm not going to take... it's a douchebag. Yeah, douchebag. He's so unfunny. It just burns my soul out of my ass.
So why did you decide to take calls?
I don't know. I'm such a sucker for... I want people to... Because I secretly want people to call up and compliment me. So, you know, I can have like an ego boost. Isn't that pathetic? So anyway.
No, it's not.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to talk a few minutes about persona. It's very important to me. It's very important to my personal philosophy. And it's very important to this album. Okay? And, you know... I've been thinking a lot for a long, long time about the idea of persona and what it means to me, what it means to this show, what it means to all sorts of things like this. And I'm going to tell you what. This album, The Minx, and I hesitate to call it an album. What it really is it's like a meditation. It's about 20-something minutes long. It's one track. You listen to it straight through, preferably with great headphones on, which you're not going to get. You're just going to be hearing it on the radio now. But essentially, it's my voice, it's my memories, but it's somebody else's name and somebody else's persona. And that somebody else is a person by the name of Tom Stab, who actually, how do I even talk about this correctly?
Remember in the car, you did a great job.
Okay.
You're leaving out a key.
What's the need, the question is, what is the need for the psychological crutch of memory, okay? Memory... in a very linear and definitive way, informs, in my opinion, the center point of the persona, the character, and that character's connection to the current of the plot of life, okay? That's what memory is. Memory is your ability to relate, to coexist, to feel empathy and apathy and love and hate, and all that stems almost desperately from your remembered experience. Now, in my opinion, memory is the central ingredient in the flow of your persona. Your personality, your shui, you know, your being. I think that the world is changing very quickly, and I think because of many, you know, externalized stimuluses, you know, or stimuli. Is that what would you call it? A stimuli or is it stimuluses? God only knows. I think soon, ladies and gentlemen, we will all be forced to outgrow our birthright of unicentric individuality. I think soon the sheer amount of outside influence will overwhelm and eclipse the facilitations of the singular self. I think the disjointed arrangement of sensory stimulus, and by that I mean the media, the television, the radio, the internet, not to mention chemically induced stimulants, I think the evolution of that will bring forth an evolution of persona that will inevitably mirror what will become a great necessity for human duality or excessive human dimension. Okay? So let me tell you about this. Ladies and gentlemen, I have not always been Paul Hullabaloo. I've told you before, I think I've insinuated it before, and I'm going to tell you right now, I have not always been Paul Hullabaloo. I was born somebody completely different, and this is the level of honesty and the level of respect I have for you as listeners that I will let you in on the true history of me. For the first time in the history of this radio show of 2 years of broadcasting, I was born obviously under a different name. I've lived my life as a few different people. I don't know if it was out of choice or if it was out of... some form of, whether I was conducting something, I don't know. But I was born as a person named Christian White. That's the first time I've said it over the air.
I know how hard that is for you.
That's the name my parents gave me. That's the name that, quote-unquote, God gave me. My God-given name was Christian White. I grew in my late teenage years, early 20s, into somebody else. Somebody that I still feel an intrinsic connection to that's startling. Somebody that was a little bit too dangerous for me to digest and keep. And that person's name ended up being Tom Stab. Tom Stab expected a degree of militant motivation that I just couldn't provide as a human being. Tom Stab, I became Tom Stab, I think, when I lived in Europe, when I lived in Amsterdam. There was a short period of time where I engaged myself to a stimulant that I found in Amsterdam that didn't originate in Amsterdam, and it was a stimulant that was called air. And essentially, it was given to me as Christian White, and I was told that what it was what was called an anti-chemical agent. And what it was a memory inducer. And essentially, it's almost like a substance as inert as air. I mean, that's why it's called air. It comes in a little capsule, you open the capsule, breathe it in, and essentially it sends you into a memory. Now, I'm telling you this because it's the truth, and I'm telling you because it's important to you to know how to digest this album we're going to play for you called The Minx. When I took the air, when I inhaled the air during a period of my life where I would just about ingest any type of chemical, I had no consideration. I was reckless. I was unguarded. I was unprincipled. I had no discipline in my life. I was living just this uproarious and quasi-despicable existence, selfish existence. I was living only for myself and only for my own experiences, so I figured I chalked this up to experience. However, ingesting this anti-chemical agent, I became somebody else for a short period of time. I became Tom Stab. Now, I don't know if Tom Stab was a fracture of my natural persona that I happened to give a name to. I don't know, but I was Tom Stab. And while I was Tom Stab, I wrote this album. The funny thing is, now I'm Paul Hullabaloo. And I know this sounds ridiculous to you, but this is the truth. I am Paul Hullabaloo. I'm not Tom Stab. I'm not Christian White. I'm Paul Hullabaloo. I don't know if I'm always going to be Paul Hullabaloo, although I'm extremely comfortable as Paul Hullabaloo. I think out of any persona I've inhabited in my life, I think Paul Hullabaloo is the one I'm the most comfortable with. So, but all three of us share a memory pool. All three of us share the same body. It's, you know, it's kind of the same car, different driver principle. This isn't multiple personality disorder either. This is a voluntary and controlled persona state where I can essentially shift persona. I can shift things. It's something I was somewhat taught also while I lived in Europe with the cringe, and something that I've kind of had an instinctual kind of innate ability to do in the first place. Essentially, what it leads to is the fact that I'm completely disoriented most of the time. I wake up in the middle of the night and I don't know who I am, and I'm constantly trying to get a grip on my psychological well-being because of it, but it's something I wouldn't give up. Because like I said, I think that the world is evolving, and I think human beings are evolving more than just physically. I think the physical evolution of human beings is a very slow, you know, almost like an iceberg type process. However, I think the evolution of the persona is quicker. I think that it's a necessity thing. I think sooner than later, human beings are going to need to be more than one person over the span of a normal life in order to deal with the extreme amount of stimulus being, you know, perpetrated on you, being pushed on you, being pushed into you. It almost seems like it's too much for one personality, for one persona to digest in a lifetime. That's how I look at it. I don't know. Have I gone crazy? Am I crazy? Am I scaring people away? Mark?
Well, you scare me at times.
I know.
You're going crazy. You're way crazy.
I just think people are consciously informed by a plethora of interior vocal agendas all day. I think you hear voices in your head all day, whether you care to admit it or identify it as such or not. I think everybody is constantly everybody else all the time. I don't think there is anybody that's singular ever. I think you're different based on where you are in a course of a day. You're a different person many times. You know, I've just happened to name the different people that I am and have learned to identify when I am existing as one of these other personalities. I don't know. I'm being very honest with you. I know I'm meandering. My point is meandering. I'm not being clear, and I'm feeling a little weird. We walked 17 miles today and had stress, and now I'm stressed out. I just think it boils down to, if you multiply, this evolution of persona will exist because if you multiply the veins of solipsist reinvention in solipsist, I don't know how do you say how you put it, the word for an ism, but what it means, it's the obsession with the self. If you multiply the veins of that with a coefficient of uncircumcised necessity, you arrive at a product of socialized discontentedness as personically charged evolution. That's what I'm talking about. Right now, everyone's like, what the F is he talking about? Somebody call the police, because he's insane and he's roaming around a college campus.
Somebody actually gave you a ride tonight.
It's a good thing I have a scalpel. What? No, I don't know what I'm talking about. Hello? I don't know. I just think, you know, I don't know. The hell with it. I'm sick of this show. I'm sick of it! I'm sick of it! I don't want to be here anymore. I've had it. Let's just play the album.
Sounds good.
So, ladies and gentlemen, this is my voice, like I said. These are my memories, but this is not my name. And this is not me. This is Tom Stab. Miracle Mark Wilcox, of course. Produced, engineered, and did the soundscapes for this album. What is it like working with Tom Stab versus Paul Hullabaloo? Is there a difference? In consistency, maybe? That's what I think.
I'm confused. I don't know who I was working with. Yeah. I was working with all three, maybe. I don't know.
Maybe that's how everybody is all the time.
I think when you hear it and you listen to what you're saying, everything you're saying now makes a little more, bit more sense, maybe.
I don't know. It could just be, like I said, naming the fundamental fractures of my own discombobulated personality. I don't know. Trust me, I know it might be challenging to understand this or challenging to appreciate this that I'm telling you right now, but just imagine if it was your internal being, if this is you, and there was no singular you, and every day you woke up with the sun shining through your windows and your face waking you up in the morning, and you have to first ask yourself, well, who am I today? Who am I? What is my agenda today?
Now, your Tom Stab persona, we don't see that very much anymore, do we? Or we haven't in a while.
He's too much for me.
He's too much.
He asks too much, but he always is there. I feel myself informed more by his persona than maybe any other. So I don't know. So this album, this conceptual piece, this meditation of remembrance is called The Minx. And I wanted to share it with you because it's the externalization of part of my internal self. And I think it's important to be fully honest and disclose those types of things to you people. So I'm sharing this with you right now. So here it is. And then we'll be back in the last 5 or so minutes. Maybe I'll take a couple calls. I don't know. Otherwise, you know, we'll just say goodbye and good night. And next week you'll tune back into the radio show and we'll be back to fun and games. And you can forget I ever said any of this if you want. Okay? Here it is.
Of other men tried to pull me up and out of all of this all at once. 7 or 8 some odd minutes before that, I was a twice in a lifetime nothing. A brow-beaten cheat overachiever, bent on creating heat for the empire of underlings I just couldn't get enough of. And all in the name of stimulants. All for the Pilgrim's Cross of Promise resting at the bottom of the shiny wet rock pockets of children found filed into the nooks of brightly lit and powder-clean neighborhoods, where the air smells as careful and as trustworthy as a rabbit's foot, mixed ever so slightly with the faintest scent of overdue library books, last season's baited hooks, and hot-boiled cinnamon apples left out on a windowsill, one memory too long. there, cornered by the mindful common lust of it all, was 404 still. Down the easement, waiting slow, mired by silent Doberman Pinscher, elastic tail anger untrue. Crushing tadpoles between thumb and middle finger, short sleeping hair, oily and resentful, trailing behind the green echo of growth denied to her. The cut and scratch chamber fever swelling against her cradled porcelain features. Rose petal lips brought to breathing and left guarded behind the warm mahogany. Missing handle cabinets below the coral blue guest bathroom sink. The door clicking on its magnet when the pressure would change. Waiting slow. Waiting. Slow.
I want you to know that when I was a child, I developed a friend who is known exclusively to me as 404. She was engineered to accompany me on many of the lulling family getaways that regulated my youth. She would tease my ribs across otherwise silent 205-mile car rides. To towards the lush comfort of the smells like someone else cottages that dotted the numb cold green East Coast like the tiny clusters of wet sand highlighting the peculiar hang of my little boy's skin-tight saltwater creased swimming trunks. I would always manage to steal the exact same smell from behind the exact same ear and always at the exact same moment. Always while stubbing our gamey green flip-flop toes on the rocky beachfront low tide, while pretending to be harmless, while bumping wrists, while walking, while poking at a passing horseshoe crab, while kneeling in its drag. The last time I can naturally remember seeing her, my senses restricted from the sterile searing grip of the anti-chemical agent known as air. She was rendered subtle and static, gracing herself face narrow and blessed biological by the yellow interstate lamps we two would cruise past, as fast and as unsettled as the oxygen red come-on of Grand Mal epilepsy, with 404 beside me, bathing in dull blue reflective light, breaking her still passenger side window gaze just long enough to lob her structure my way, her fragile pale jaw jarring close to my collar, whispering to me in ethnic tones, alien and subdued, whispering at night that the light at the end of the tunnel is simply the light of another tunnel. And it wasn't until that moment, that specific splinter of fractured time, that I realized, that I knew, that in all of the moments of the then, that it comprised the whole of the now, in all of that time, she had never before used her voice. And then I realized that that was the first time she had ever needed to use it. That was the last time I saw her. That was the last time.
Leave and enter time.
The minx meanders her way east as the stiff dim drop of stale natural test pattern quiet forms, scattering itself against the roughly sheared and resin-caked square of cut-up cardboard box fit into the crash of pained elmwood glass that my ankle and shin remembered, respectful of its gated applause. Raised fist, turncoat, dignity undone again in anticipation of the catchphrase. The slight sound wind tricking itself underneath the historical district windowsill wood, warped by the new nervous ghetto air, while downstairs smells spill, fighting with the rise of struggling heater outtake, rippling the March air like an illusionary Arizona highway horizon. The minx closes over and signals all the way from Sonoyta through Tucson, huddled under the brim of Texas style by the confidently hidden voice commanding with satire and pseudonym, caught through the collapse of yesterday's condensation and the sun-bleached kick-up of a North Mexican dirt road made for a great shot, didn't it? Seems to me to be the stark call of Amsterdam all over again. Leaves me molded by the very design she knows I can no longer support. But the minx meanders her way east anyway, desperate. Amsterdam. Amsterdam again. I'm down deep in this now, deep in the weight. But it wasn't always this way. It wasn't always this way. We'll be right back.
everything I ever see.
I was woken up 2 days ago by the trees, and I almost wish, you know, I could have the capability of just falling back asleep, but I'm pretty sure, you know, it has something to do with what I was thinking about. What I was thinking about before I fell asleep in the first place, but I don't know, I guess that's how things go. Just have to, essentially just have to roll with the punches, right? You just have to wake up, get yourself up, just keep going. The minute you stop is when you suffocate. If you suffocate, then I guess you reach some sort of shrouded nirvana, I suppose. And at that point, there is no more philosophy, there's no more latent understanding, it's all just end time at that point, it's all just end time. So, that was 2 days ago. God knows what I'll be doing 2 days from now. Right? 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 Right?
So that was called The Minx. Mark and Tom Stab put that together. Mark and I put that together, I don't know, a year ago. If you want to have a copy of that, if you would like to listen to that again, or if you'd be interested in that, you know, you could send me an email with your mailing list, and I'll send you a free copy. That's nopositive@AOL.com. You know, I'm just so disappointed in myself because I failed to express... I always feel so... constricted by the time I have to sit in front of this microphone. I feel that I can talk my ass off in normal life. When I get in front of the microphone and I have 1 hour and there's this, you know, microphone in front of me, I have a difficult time expressing myself clearly. And today I really wanted to express to you something very clearly, and I failed. I don't know. I don't know what I think. I don't know what I think. But what I let you hear there, that's... I just let you in to the inside of my head. I just gave you the inside of my head, a little fracture of it, you know, of the inside of my brain, just for you. It's the seed of what's to come, ladies and gentlemen. And that's just part of my goddamn lunatic prophecy right there. And I also play it and I get some sort of emotional erection out of the fact that it's going out over the airwaves in 404 out there somewhere, quietly, sitting somewhere, waiting. Can hear that. It's like a homing signal. My silent other side floating around emptily. I don't know. What a weird mood I'm in today. Mark, you? Laugh it up, Fuzzball.
I feel bad for you.
It's confusing. It's disorienting, but it's my life. And I hope that you can at least appreciate the fact that I, as weird as things can get here for this 1 hour every Sunday night, I'm giving it to you truthfully by lying to you. So there you go. Anyone want to have one last word? You can call in 792-9030. I'll give the last word to you as long as it's not a douchebag. I'll give you the last word. If you have something quasi-interesting to share, ask, or contribute in any way, shape, or form, you're welcome to call in.
Oh.
Let's try it. This person's either going to spoil it or make me happy. Let's find out. Hello.
Hello, Paul.
Hello.
Hello, Blue.
Hi there.
I would like to say I've been listening to your show since the middle of the summer.
Okay.
And I feel almost cheated by you.
Why?
Because I've identified with you so well during the last 10 or 12 weeks or however long it's been. And then all of a sudden you just take me on this psychotic odyssey.
I'm telling you, though, I live a dynamic life, and I don't say that in any sort of, you know, look at me, listen to me. But I do. I have a my existence has been dynamic, and I wouldn't trade it with anybody else's in the world. And I can only give you where I am for this hour every single week, no matter where it is. But I give it to you no matter what, without any pre-programming. And if I throw you in weird directions, I apologize, but I ask the loyal to stay with me, because eventually all of this will tie together and make sense.
But it frightens me, because I identified with you so well up until this point.
Well,
try being his friend.
Yeah, try knowing me and living with me.
All right. Well, I don't think I'll try that, but...
So what, you're never going to listen to me again?
Well, I won't live with you.
But will you continue to listen?
Yeah.
Do you still love me?
Well, I don't know if love had been established yet. It was only a few months.
Well, do you feel some sort of compassion for me?
I guess, yeah.
Can you at least give me that?
Yeah,
I have to sleep tonight.
I feel compassion, Paul.
What's your name?
John.
Hello, John.
Hello, Paul.
Well, I'm just in a very strange mood, and I wish I could have been clearer. If I had 3 hours or 2 hours, I could have been clearer with everybody.
Can I share a thought that I wanted to a week or two ago?
Hit me.
You were talking about Doe, the head of Heaven's Gate cult.
Oh, yeah, Marshall Applewhite.
Right. He's a man that fascinates me beyond belief because of that photo on the cover of Time magazine.
Just a brilliant... He used the television, the cathode ray tube, so brilliantly, it's impossible to think of anyone who could possibly eclipse him.
Another thing very fascinating to me, I'm a teenager right now, and I grew up playing a lot of kind of cheesy Super Nintendo games, most of them being made by Interplay.
Right.
And I read that the majority of the Heaven's Gate cult worked for Interplay because they worked very cheap. They would do small tasks for very small amounts of money. And I feel that somehow the reason that I'm attracted to Doe so much is maybe subliminally they've implanted some kind of message or instilled some kind of belief into these games at Interplay.
Well, the truth of all things is that all day you're being bombarded subliminally. Everybody knows that. That's an obvious statement. So yeah, I'm sure I can almost tell you positively that I guarantee that you were subliminally induced with certain messages that weren't your own. But that kind of ties into what I'm talking about here, where I firmly believe, and I've got to wrap up here, but I firmly believe that soon the time will come where human beings will not be able to digest all of this information unilaterally anymore. And it will become a time where human beings need to develop a different level of comprehensive dimension. See what I'm saying?
Yes.
I don't know. Maybe they're right. They're flying behind the comet, and the world's going to end, and we're all trapped here. Amen. Right?
Right. With Klingons.
Okay. Nachra. That's with Klingon for okay.
Oh, all right.
All right. I got to wrap it up. Thank you, John, for your call.
Thank you very much, Paul.
Please continue to listen, and please try to learn to love me, love all other living creatures, except for the blacks.
Okay.
Bye. I have to ruin everything at the end. I don't know. F me and F you and F the rest of it. Who gives a flying frog's fat ass anymore? If you want to contact me or the show, Miracle, as always, I tell you in the privacy of our own life, but you did such brilliant engineering and production on that album. I'll never forgive you. Forgive you, yeah. I'll never forgive
you. You ruined the whole
thing. Damn it, it should have been a pile of crap. No, I love you. I love you all very much. That's why I share my insanity with you. And I don't believe it's insanity. I'm not going to give a disclaimer here. It's my life, and I'm giving it to you 1 hour at a time. If you want to talk to me, nopositive@aol.com. nopositiveradio.fanspace.com is the website.
Say hi to Dirty John.
Dirty John, we love you, of course. He'll be back next week. And we'll be back next Sunday night at 8 with more of this BS nonsense. I love you very much, and I do consider you and think of you at all times. And I love you too, Mom. All right. Until next week, this is Paul Hullblue asking you kindly. By the way, Kind Sounds and Aaron up next. Big Aaron, so stay tuned. Until next week, email me. Please email me, nopositive@aol.com. It makes me feel connected. Please. Please. Subject. oppose, subvert, and continue to live the lie.